Welcome students, I am Swati Saraswat, Associate Professor in Mechanical Engineering Department at LD College of Engineering. Last time we discussed about air compressors, how it is working. We studied the working of reciprocating air compressor. We also studied the different terminologies used in the air compressor, and we also discussed about the uses of compressed air. So I think now it is very much clear that what is the function of a compressor and how it works. To go further, today we will discuss about these many topics. The first one is effect of clearance volume, need for multi-staging in a compressor, what are the problems with a single stage compressor. Third topic is method for approximating to isothermal compression. Then we will see multi-stage compression and its advantages. Next we will also cover the construction and working of rotary compressors. In that we have two types, roots blower and vane blower. And lastly we would like to understand the comparison of reciprocating and rotary compressors. So in the last class I told you that what is the clearance volume and how does it affect the performance of a compressor. Now clearance volume is a air which remains in the cylinder after the end of delivery stroke. I have written it here. It is the after the end of delivery stroke, all the air is not delivered into the receiver, but some part of air still stays within the cylinder and occupies the space inside the cylinder. That is called the clearance volume. Now what happens that, as you can see in this PV diagram, this is the suction stroke 6-1. From 1 to 2 the air is compressed, and from 2 to 5 the air is delivered into the receiver tank. Now here we can see this is the clearance volume VC, which that is the amount of air which is left within the cylinder. So the actual swept volume is starting after VC. You can see that I have shown it as VS, right? And what happens to the performance of the compressor because of the clearance volume? You can see here, during the next suction stroke, after the delivery stroke, for the next suction stroke, this volume of clearance volume is expanding. This clearance volume air is expanding, as it is shown by line 3-4, and it will reach up to 0.4. So as such, the swept volume is from this point V3 to V1. The actual fresh air which is sucked by the compressor is only V1 minus V4. So this is the actual volume of air taken inside the compressor. As such, it should have been VS. So we can see that the amount of air sucked by the compressor is reduced because of the clearance volume. If there was no clearance volume, no expansion, and the total volume of air actually sucked would be equal to VS. So I have listed it here. VC is the clearance volume, VS is swept volume, VA is the actual volume of air, that is V1 minus V4. So this 3-4, as I said, it is the expansion of clearance volume during the next suction stroke. And Because of this, the volumetric efficiency, which is the ratio of actual volume of air sucked to the swept volume, is decreasing. Because the compressor is not able to take more amount of fresh air and it is not able to deliver more air. So, the volumetric efficiency is less. So, what does it mean that if pressure ratio is high, the volumetric efficiency will reduce because more high delivery pressure will result into more expansion of air, and more expansion of air will reduce the actual volume of air sucked inside. So I think this is clear to you. This is a very important parameter in the working and the performance of the air compressor. Some amount of clearance volume is required to provide cushioning effect to the valves. But at the same time, the clearance volume should not be too large. So we have to decide for some optimum value of clearance volume for the effective performance. Okay. Now, last time I discussed about the working of reciprocating single stage reciprocating air compressor, and I had also shown the PV diagram for that, and we discussed that if we go for isothermal compression, the efficiency of the compressor will increase, because if the temperature is high, the molecules of air will try to, temperature is high, the molecules of air will try to go away from each other and its compression would be difficult. So, periodically, if you are able to reduce the temperature of air, it will help in increasing the efficiency of compressor and will reduce the work requirement. So, we can see it here. This 1-2 is the line showing the adiabatic compression. PV raised to 1.4 is equal to constant, and the innermost line is the isothermal compression, and we are not able to, ideally it should be isothermal, but we are not able to achieve exactly isothermal compression by any means. So what we get is a polytropic kind of compression shown by this line. So we can see that there is a reduction in work required by this much of area. So even if you are not able to go for complete isothermal compression, we can try to approach it by various methods used for isothermal compression. One such method is cold water spray. We can spray cold water on the outer side of the cylinder and thereby cooling the air within it. Second method is water jacketing. This is the common method used for cooling, in which a water jacket is there surrounding the cylinder and which continuously takes the water around it. The cold water goes inside, hot water comes out, and likewise it will cool the cylinder. Third is intercooling by using multi-stage compression. So we'll see this into detail. What is intercooling? There we use two cylinders in which the compression is carried out. In between there is an intercooling. Okay. Now, what is the problem with single stage compression? Why we should go for multi-stage? In single stage, what happens is, if there is one single cylinder in which the whole compression is taking place like this, in one single cylinder. This is atmospheric air compressed to, let's say, 5 bar pressure in a single cylinder. Then what happens? As you can see, the pressure range is high here, so there can be leakages surrounding the piston rings, because as the pressure range is high, pressure difference is high, there is more likeliness of leakage of air. Second is, we can only go for after cooling, or as I said, by a water jacket surrounding the cylinder we can cool the air. So the cooling is not very effective in this, resulting in more work required. Third is, cylinder needs to be very heavy and robust, because this single cylinder has to withstand the pressure of 5 bar. So it has to be constructed robust and heavy to withstand the 5 bar pressure, which adds to the cost. Volumetric efficiency is less, because as I said, if the pressure ratio is high, the volumetric efficiency will reduce, and so the capacity of the compressor will be less. And lastly, because the pressure is high and the temperature inside also will be high of the air, so because of the high temperature inside the cylinder, sometimes it creates lubricating problems, because of the high temperature, sometimes the lubrication oil may get damaged or contaminated, and proper lubrication is not provided on the cylinder walls. So to overcome this problem, we went for multi-stage compressor. So you can see here instead of one cylinder, we have two cylinders. One is called low pressure cylinder, the other is high pressure cylinder, and air is compressed to its final pressure in partly in one cylinder and partly in second cylinder, that is in two stages. So we can see here, this is the air, atmospheric air at pressure P1, which is taken inside the cylinder during the suction stroke. Then there is a compression stroke, the air is compressed to pressure P2 and it is delivered into the intercooler. Before passing it to the next cylinder, it passes through the intercooler. In the intercooler, there is a cooling water circulated inside, and which is cooling this air which is passing through it. The pressure remains constant, but the temperature of the air will reduce. This air then goes to the suction of high pressure cylinder. Then there is a delivery stroke, and the pressure of this air is then increased to P3, and this air then goes to the receiver. It is stored in the receiver at the desired pressure. So for example, let's say if we want to have the final pressure as 5 bar, we can compress from 1 bar to 2 bar in the low pressure cylinder. That is, P2 pressure will be 2 bar. Then it goes to intercooler, and a kind of, we try to achieve isothermal compression by passing it through intercooler. We reduce the temperature of air, and then it goes to the high pressure cylinder. So from 2 bar to 5 bar, the pressure is increased in the high pressure cylinder. So we can see that there are certain advantages with this. What is the advantage? You can see, one thing is, Or first we see this multi-stage compression on a PV diagram. Then we will discuss the advantages. So you can see here, this is point 1 from where the suction starts. 0 to 1 is the suction. 1 to 2 is compression in the first cylinder, adiabatic compression, LP cylinder. Then there is an intercooling which is shown by 2 dash, and this is the isothermal line. So exactly we are not reaching up to point 2 double dash on the isothermal line, but by intercooling we are approaching towards isothermal compression and it reaches point 2 dash here somewhere. This air is then sucked in the high pressure cylinder and then it is compressed here from 2 dash to 3 dash. So instead of 2 to 3, now the compression is from 2 dash to 3 dash. And then it is delivered 2 dash to 3 dash in high pressure compressor, pressure cylinder. And then from 3 dash to 4, it is delivered in the receiver tank at pressure P3. So we can see that there is a work saved due to intercooling, this much area, 2, 2 dash, 2, 3, 3 dash, 2 dash. That is the work saved due to intercooling. So what are the advantages of this? We try to understand. What happens is, because of the intercooling, as we discussed earlier, there is a kind of isothermal compression and so the work required will be less. Now, when you are having compression in two cylinders, this cylinder which is handling low pressure compared to this has to be light in weight and it does not need to be very robust because it is going to handle low pressure. While the HP cylinder, it is going to handle high pressure, so only this cylinder has to be made robust and heavy. So there is a saving in cost and the balancing, mechanical balancing is also better. Another advantage is the temperature. The temperature inside will not rise very high and so the lubricating problems will be reduced. Cooling is effective, then there is no leakage because the pressure ratio in individual cylinder is now reduced. Pressure ratio here is only from 5 to 2 bar. Here it is 2 to 1 bar. So the leakage problem of air will be reduced because the pressure is less. Volumetric efficiency will increase. And overall, the efficiency of compressor will improve. So that is why most of the compressors are today used with intercooling. Next, we come to the construction and working of rotary compressor. So, we have completed the reciprocating compressor, which is also a positive displacement type of compressor. I discussed it last class. What is a positive displacement type of compressor? In which the compression of air is taking place by reduction in volume of air. And these are generally used for high pressure applications. There is no slip. In the same category, that is in the positive displacement type of compressors, we have rotary compressors. in that, the first one is the roots blower. How does it work and what are its parts? We will see. We can see that this is the, there are two rotors or lobes. This is rotor 1, this is rotor 2, which is enclosed in an airtight casing, and they rotate in this casing on their axis. This is the inlet from where the low pressure atmospheric air will enter. As the lobes will rotate, you can see they are airtight within the casing. So the pockets of air will be entrapped in between the lobes and the casing, and the volume of air will be compressed. That much volume of air will be compressed and it will be delivered in the receiver. Now there is also backflow sometimes from the backflow of air from the receiver to the casing, unless the desired pressure in the receiver is obtained. So what will happen? This lobe is rotating and allowing this air to go into the receiver, but at the same time some air may flow back within the casing. So that is how there is constantly pushing of volume within the receiver, and that is why it is called positive displacement kind of compressor. Here we have shown two rotors. Sometimes there can be three rotors also, right? So you can see these parts. Now what are its features? Now these compressors are used for pressures up to 10 bar. Up to 10 bar pressure can be generated by the rotary compressors, and these are high capacity compressors. So around 3000 meter cube per minute of air can be discharged by this compressor. So mainly it is used for high discharge, low pressure applications, where we want to go for high discharge of air. We want to go for high discharge of air and the pressure is comparatively less, around 10 bar. And as we can see here, it is a continuous air delivery type of compressor which will continuously deliver the high pressure air, and it rotates at a very high speed. So in this, one of the rotor will be rotated initially. One of the rotor will be rotated by some external means, some motor, some electric motor or some prime mover, which will drive this lobe, and by the gear type of mashing with the another lobe, the other lobe will also rotate and it will move within the casing and will compress the air and push it in the receiver. So we will stop here today, and next time we will continue with the vane blower and the comparison between rotary compressors and reciprocating compressors, and we will also discuss about centrifugal and axial flow type of compressors. I hope you understood the topic well and it was interesting enough, and we will discuss the remaining things within the next class. Thank you.